Got me. All right. Well, amen. Well, amen. Hate mess everybody up. We're going to have break time at camp. Well, amen. All righty then. All right, amen. Good to see everybody here. It's good to see everybody here on this second Sunday in June. It's good to see everybody. Can you hear me? Everybody hear me? Am I on? I'm on back there? I appreciate that. That helps me out. Yeah, yeah. Well, it's good to see everybody here on this second Sunday of June. Boy, I sure did miss last week. We went to my wife's people have a reunion. They call it a decoration. And it's a great time of remembering those that have gone on home and been with the Lord, all those that have passed away, soldiers, all the people. It was really good because they had her family, folks done some ancestry stuff, and they visited cemeteries. I got sand gnats up here. Y'all see me do this all day. That'd be my Holy Spirit wave. But we got to go see some of her ancestors in some of those Alabama cemeteries way back in the woods that fought all the way back in the American Revolution, all the way back. So it was good for Emma, because she gets to see where her people and all, so it's all mapped out in that, so maybe one day she can take off her people. But it's good to see everybody here. We're glad to have our visitors. I know that today we're having our baby dedication service, and as soon as I get done with this prayer, we're going to go ahead and do it, and that way, because babies sometimes need nursery, and if they don't, they can stay out here. Babies don't bother me in the least. It's good stuff. But real quick, our youth camp is in North Georgia, June 25th through the 30th. It's an odd time. It's from a Thursday through a Tuesday, but it was the time that we could get the lodge, so our kids are pretty much lined up. We have a couple that are still deciding. If you're wondering if you can go, if you're a young person and you're wondering if you can go, we got room for you. So don't not go because you think, well, I hadn't told anybody. And listen, everything's been chaotic for the past 3 months. So if you want to go, see me after church, and we will work it out. We'll make it happen, okay? So keep that in mind. We're going to have a meeting right after church this morning with our leaders of summer camp. If you're one of the leaders that are going, to help out with that, just meet me in my office, if you would, right after services so we can get that done. Any other announcements? July 4th, we're going to have a get-together here at church. Looking to have some fireworks. We got the fire department going to be here, but it would be good if we let the people know right around here what's going on when they hear fireworks. You know, you don't want to be rude or disrespectful to folks that live right here. So it'd be a good thing if we seen some of the folks that live right here on the road or right down beside the church. So if somebody could help us with that, that'd be a blessing. We're going to have hamburgers, get together. We thought probably later in the evening because it gets dark a little later. Fireworks are better when it gets dark. So there's sand gnats out there too. I see some of y'all fans of sand gnats. That's awesome. I'm glad it ain't just me. Amen. Amen. Are there any prayer requests this morning? We got several from last week and this past week. Also, Miss Eloise Watkins is in hospice here in Waycross. Remember that family, her and that family in your prayers. Any others? Remember Eldon Mixon? Any others? Say it again, I'm sorry. Eli Statham family. Any others? Bill. Bill Vaughn. Any others? Remember Miss Jewel Chancy? She's one of our folks in the crowd. She's has the best spirit of anybody I've probably ever been around. She loves the Lord, and she's doing breast cancer treatments now for cancer. So keep her in your prayers. Any others? Any unspoken this morning? Amen. Remember our country and the sad state of affairs that our government has allowed it to get into. We pay taxes so that our government takes care of some things. And undoubtedly, they don't see those things as very important. I do personally. So this morning, my title of my sermon is Christian Lives Matter. So we're going to talk about that this morning. And we're going to take a biblical look at who we are as Christians and our obligation to our government. So we're going to have a word of prayer. And after this word of prayer, we're going to go ahead and have our baby dedication service. And we get that over. Is that okay with y'all? Miss Olivia, you good? Okay. I see the Sweeneys. There they are. You know, I can't see half of y'all with my glasses, so I know there's people out there, but let's have a word of prayer. Let's pray. Lord, we love you. We thank you, God, that you look our way and recognize that we need you. Lord, we're thankful today that as we come into your house, God, that we can come and ask for prayer and know, God, that you hear our prayers and that, Lord, when we come with a right heart, a contrite spirit, Lord, and Lord, we know that you hear our prayers and Lord, you answer them the best way you see fit. So help us, God, as your people to recognize that we're sinful people and that we need a heavenly Father who can forgive us of our sins, and we have that in you. Lord, we pray for these prayer requests. We lift them up to you, God, and pray that you'll take care of each one in only the way that you know how. God, you alone know to what degree these prayer requests, Lord, will be answered. Help us, Lord, to understand and recognize them. Lord, I lift up Brother Roger Veeley to you, and just pray, God, you'll bless him today. Talk to Miss Cindy this morning, Lord, and I just pray you'll bless Brother Roger and give him strength. Pray for Miss Cindy, and we just pray, Lord, that you'll be there with him and give him strength over this week as he goes through his chemo treatments again, and just pray, God, you'll be beside him. We love you, Lord. We recognize that you love us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're going to forego, just for the time being, for maybe a few more weeks, the visiting around after this, for people that's worried about shaking hands or whatever. We're going to try to do our best, okay? But listen, I can't tell you not to shake hands or hug necks. That's your business, all right? But what we'll do this morning, first thing, is let's have our parents come up, if you would, that are having our babies dedicated. Amen. I wrote everything down so I wouldn't forget. Amen. How beautiful. Does the grandparents, listen, y'all want to come up here and sit while they, won't y'all come sit right up here? The family, y'all come sit right here. We got room. Y'all come sit up here. Can y'all speak to see okay?
Oh, yeah.
Y'all good?
Yeah, good.
Okay. All right. All righty. I could have said great-grandparents, Mr. Collin. I forget, you're a great-grandparent. Time flies by, don't it? And your great-grandmother's here?
Oh, my grandmother.
How about all your people, all her people stand up? Let's just see you. That's awesome. Look at there. Amen. Okay. How about all your people stand up? Is that okay? Awesome. Man, we could start a football team right here. We got a crowd of people. Amen. The little children were brought to Jesus early in his ministry. And the first thing to happen is the disciples rebuked all the children and said, listen, you better stand back from our Savior. And the first thing Jesus said back to them was, let the little children come to me. There was a reason why, because as little children, that's how we come to know Christ as our Savior. We come as little children, believing simply by faith to come into the fold. The family is a divine institution ordained of God from the beginning of time. Children are a heritage of the Lord, committed by Him to their parents for care, provision, protection, and spiritual training. It is good when parents recognize all these obligations and responsibilities and make every effort to fully care them out. In this act of dedication, these moms and dads are carrying out the responsibilities before us today to dedicate themselves and their children to God and His will for their lives as a family. Now, we dedicate children rather than baptize them. Nowhere in Scripture is there a precedent for child baptism. But we dedicate children, and in that dedication, church, you're part of it. Because we as a church have a responsibility, not only mom and dad, but we have a responsibility to the moms and dads and the children as a church to have a place that's fit and ready and open so they can all come to God's house and worship and grow and learn about Jesus. That's our responsibility. So I'm going to have you in just a minute stand with us here in just a minute. Now, I'm going to do this side first, and then I'll do this side. That okay? Okay. Okay. Taylor and Emily, you have brought Madeline Rebecca before us today to publicly dedicate her to the Lord. I got a couple of questions. Will you accept your God-given responsibilities to raise Madeline in a Christ-centered home? Mm-hmm. Am I saying Madeline, or is it Madeline?
It's Madeline.
I was making sure it wasn't lying. So I got Adeline and Madeline. Will you teach and discipline her in your home so that you're not solely dependent on the church or school system to impart biblical knowledge and spiritual values to Madeline?
We will.
Amen. As a mom, you're her earthly mother. Will you give her that special attachment that she'll crave as she gets older, and that'll nurture her and she'll grow in a way that only you can grow her? Will you do that?
No.
As a dad, Taylor, will you provide a home that's safe for her forever?
I will.
Amen. That's good stuff. Here we go. Tyler and Olivia, you have brought Adeline Ray. It's a great name, Adeline Ray, before us today to publicly dedicate her to the Lord. I got just a couple of questions. Will you accept your God-given responsibility to raise her in a Christ-centered home? Will you teach and discipline her in your home so that you are not solely dependent on the church or the school system to impart biblical knowledge and spiritual values? As a mom, will you, as her earthly mother, give her that special attachment that she's going to crave from you and that special nurturing that only a mama can give? And as a daddy, will you always give her a home that she feels safe in?
I will.
Amen. Church, would you please stand with me for a moment? Congregation, will you, as the community of faith, support Taylor and Tyler and Emily and Olivia and their children by Christian love and example set by their lives? Will you do those things? If so, say, we will.
We will.
You can be seated. Let's pray together. Lord, we thank you so much for these young people and Lord, these young couples with these children, Lord, it's the true backbone and strength of our church. Lord, we have an obligation to them, Lord, to bring a place and have a place ready, Lord, so they can come weekly and learn about you. Help us, Lord, to never waver in our responsibility to them. Lord, as pastor of this church, Lord, I recognize that responsibility and don't take it lightly. Lord, I pray for our leadership in this church that we always keep in mind the decisions that we make reflect themselves in the lives of these little ones. So, Lord, help us to always remember why we're here. Help us, God, to serve you, do it in such a way that brings honor and glory to you and makes it a great and fun place for our children to come to. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. I've got some Bibles for you.
Good morning. I'd like to welcome you to Oak Hill Baptist Church this morning. Get everyone to stand with us and help us sing Thank You, Lord.
Today, and there's just one thing that I want to say.
If I can get his guitar on. Sorry, guys. We're just going to roll on. The monitor's out, I think. It's hard to hear up here without that on. Roll on, James.
Ain't God good? For 40 long years, God's people journeyed in the wilderness, searching for Canaan and bliss in promised land. They never went too hungry, they never got too thirsty, but the more that God keep blessing them, the more they would complain. Ain't God good? Give us so many blessings undeserving. That's what we are. We ought to thank Him, love and praise Him a little more today, a whole lot more tomorrow. In the times that we live, so many here are thankful, and many more to fail to see that God has given all. Working, praying for cars, new homes, TVs, and carpet wall to wall. Ain't God good? Give us so many blessings undeserving. That's what we are. We all to praise Him, love and praise Him a little more today, a whole lot more tomorrow. Ain't God good? To give us so many blessings undeserving, that's what we are. We all to thank Him, love and praise Him a little more today, a whole lot more tomorrow. Ain't God good? So many blessings undeserving. That's what we are. We ought to thank Him, love and praise Him a little more today, a whole lot more tomorrow. Ain't God good?
Heavenly Father, we want to say thank you today.
Sing a special for church. Now, I don't know. It could be a story, Brother John. I heard you singing for church. I was just hoping. And he's so expressive. Amen. Amen. Now, take your Bibles with me. Turn to the book of Mark, chapter 12. Mark, chapter 12. Tonight, I'd like if you come back tonight, please do. You know, of course, every preacher always says that's a gimmick, you know, trying to get people to come back on Sunday nights. Truth is, tonight I'm going to give a response to, tonight I'm going to give a response to our Southern Baptist Convention's president, Reverend J.D. Greer, who come out this week. I wouldn't say in favor of Black Lives Matter, but clouded the water. And if there's ever a time that Christians need to be ringing the bell and that clarion call be clear. It's today. It's today. During the revolution of our country, when men were deciding whether or not to stand up against England to make this nation a great nation that it is today, the central cultural spot was its churches. And there was a whole, as a regiment called the Black Robed Regiment that worked in the communities. And that group of Black Robed Regiment was its preachers. And I think it's important that the church rings the bell. So this morning I'm going to preach on a subject that's going to address this partly, but not in whole, not in whole. It's I want to talk to us first of all about we've heard Black Lives Matter, White Lives Matter. Listen, all lives matter. I mean, we hear it all the time, and it's true. All lives matter. But today I want to talk to you about Christian lives matter. And listen, we in America are at a pivotal time to where we, as people, ought to say what we believe and why we believe it. Truth is, a lot of us know what we believe, or at least we give ourselves to a certain set of ethics, but sometimes we don't know why we believe it. We just know that that's what Daddy said, that's what Grandmother said, but it's important that you get God's Word out, know what God's Word says about. I got three things this morning, but there's lots of things, but three things this morning I'm going to pick out of here, and I'm going to talk to you about Christian lives matter. I believe now more than ever. Listen, if there ever need to be a calming influence in our country, I believe it ought to come from our Christians. Listen, our country was set up on Christian beliefs by men that were Christian. Listen, our Constitution and the laws that were set up regarding it won't even work for a nation that's not Christian. That's why we're in the midst of all the turmoil that we are now. They want to change everything. And listen, I'm thankful that I live in a country that I can decide that, you know, everybody don't have to believe like I do. Listen, we're in a country, people believe exactly what they want to believe. Muslims are come here and they are fine to worship whatever they want to. That's fine. Don't mess with mine, though. Listen, the problem is folks nowadays that don't like Christianity, they're not going to be happy until they hear what they think coming out of your mouth. And that's the problem. That's the problem. And listen, we need to know what we believe, why we believe it. Listen, I'm one of those people that I don't mind a little bit of face to face with somebody that don't believe like I do. I'm okay with that. I don't mind debate. I truly don't, and I don't mind getting God's word out and telling you where I got it from. But now let's have a honest debate. And today, a lot of the issues that's going on in our country, it's not an honest debate. It's people just having to back down to keep things quiet. I'm done with that. I'm weary of that. But first of all, let's look at Mark chapter 12, verse 13. Mark chapter 12, verse 13 says this. Talks about Jesus and taxes. Well, it'd be good if we got this spot here. It says, don't pay taxes. That'd be great, wouldn't it? That'd be great. That'd be awesome, wouldn't it? But it doesn't say that. Sadly. Watch this. In Mark chapter 12, verse 13, the Bible says, And they send unto him certain of the Pharisees and of the Herodians to catch him in his words. So the Pharisees were the Romans, the Roman priest group, those of Herod, and also the Pharisees, those of the Christian priestly group. Both of them were people. Now, if Jesus did anything that day, he brought two groups of people who believed in different gods, because they didn't worship the same God, the Herodians and the Pharisees. It was different gods. But listen, they all got their legitimacy, if you will, from a divine higher power. So they kind of joined forces to come against Jesus and try to trip him up. So whenever we're reading this, understand where it's coming from. It wasn't coming from just a group of passive Christians who were just wanting to know. No, these were a group of, I'll just say it out loud, salesmen for the serpent. Listen, this was coming from a group of people that didn't want Jesus to be the Son of God or the Messiah. That's where it was coming from. They was trying to trip him up so they'd have some way of saying that in the near future they could put him on a cross and nail him and have a reason. They never could. They hung him there with lies. And so here he is today, smarter than they are, of course. He's God. And they send unto him certain of the Pharisees and the Herodians to catch him in his words. And when they were come, they said unto him, Master, we know that thou art true and carest for no man, for thou regardest not the persons of men, but teachest the way of God in truth. Is it lawful to give tribute to Caesar or not? Don't you like the way they try to put words in his mouth? It reminds me of watching Sean Hannity, who I'm okay with. But you ever notice how whenever you're watching some of their interviews, they talk for like 5 minutes, and then they ask the person a question and cut them off after 10 seconds? Does that bother anybody else? I mean, listen, ask the man a question, stand back, let him answer. That's the way I would always believe. But they let a guy talk they ask a question 10 minutes long. They'll say, isn't it true that we, and that's how they're going about it. That's what these guys were doing. They said, we know you're true and you don't have any respect to persons. So they were listening. Listen, they knew about Jesus. They had some information about him. I'm afraid to say that's what a lot of the world has today now. I believe that's what a lot of Americans have today now, is just some information about Jesus, and they don't truly know Jesus. Listen, there's different people in this world today that profess that they serve Jesus but don't know him in their heart. Listen, we as Christians, when we accept Christ as our Savior, listen, literally our nature changes. We're no longer like we used to be. Listen, I can tell you how I changed, and you can tell me how you changed. And I guarantee you, if we truly changed, it was in the heart of us, not just some outward things. Because those outward things, they pass away. And the inward part of man, that's the part. Listen, I've always said it to young people when we preach to youth or young people, and I always say this to them. I said, listen, it's what's on the inside that counts. And I'll tell you that today too. You can put all the bumper stickers you want on your car, and you can put up all the signs in your yard, and you can root for whatever political person that you enjoy. But I got news for you. If you don't honor God with your life, all that to me doesn't matter. Listen, because my Savior is here for a higher calling, not just politics. We as people have to be involved in politics because we ought to vote. But listen, Christ came to this earth to recognize that he's here for more than politics. And listen, we're here for what comes after. We're here for what comes 1,000 years down the road. That's what we're here for. And the quicker we realize that and staple that and anchor ourselves to that, the more we'll recognize how much we don't belong here. Y'all all right? Y'all okay? All right. Everybody's looking at her like this right here. I'm just checking. I've been preaching so much to myself, ain't nobody in the room no more when I preach. You get all excited, you got a room full of people. Amen. Watch this. Verse 15 says, shall we give or shall we not give? The Pharisees and the Herodians were saying, shall we give or not give to Caesar? But he knew their hypocrisy and said to them, why temptest ye me? Bring me a penny that I may see it. And they brought it, and he saith unto them, whose is this image in this subscription? Now, that image that was in that superscription, I wrote it down here. I want to make sure I read it to you right. That image on that subscription said Augustus Tiberius, son of the divine Augustus. That's what was on that penny that Jesus looked at. That was what was on that denarius, that piece of money, the divine Augustus. Here's what Jesus had to say to him. And they brought it, and he saith unto them, what's the scripture? They said unto him, it's Caesar's. And Jesus answered and said unto them, render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's. How many times have we heard that throughout our life? You know, we people tell us that. And we forget the second half of that, Brother Tim. And to God the things that are God's. What Jesus said there, he said two things right there. He made it very plain to that group of people. He said, listen, you need to make sure that these monies, these things, this earthly stuff, give it back to earthly people. But when you start talking about divine things, son, you better give what belongs to God. And that, listen, we can have it wrote on our money in God we trust, but I can guarantee you that there's more evil done with those dollars with in God we trust wrote on it than you'd ever understand. There's more evil done by governments with the monies that we turn in for taxes. But I got news for you. We're to be good citizens. That's tough, isn't it? It's tough. But listen, we're to be good citizens. You say, well, Brother Ray, I thought was you was going to come preach some anarchist, you know, a sermon today. Nope, not me, not me. The answer stunned the Herodians and the Pharisees because whatever differences, they were both religious. They were both religious. And they wanted to make sure that they paid obeisance to Augustus, to Tiberius, to Nero. They wanted to make sure that they let everybody know that they served their government. Listen, I got news for you. I'd rather serve God than the government. Amen. And these folks out there today that says everything that we do ought to be fashioned so that the government knows that we okay with what they're doing. I don't believe that a bit. Hey, listen, the government needs to know every now and then we don't appreciate what they do. You know what we can do? Vote their carcass out of office. Listen, folks sometimes get all out. Some folks been in public office forever, and they always get aggravated. And they wonder why the people just didn't go out and vote for them. But they did vote. They stayed at the house so you wouldn't get none. That's what happens a lot of times. Listen, in races all over America, Tuesday, folks were disheartened because folks didn't show up and vote for them. Oh, they voted. They voted. They didn't want you there, so they didn't go to put a name on your card. They voted. Listen, today we have strength in that number. There's about 14, that's almost 15 million Southern Baptists. 15 million. Listen, this is the largest evangelical group in the world. Listen, you're part of that group. Listen, but I've got a message to Mr. J.D. Greer this evening in our evening service. Listen, that I am weary as a pastor of a Southern Baptist church trying to explain the foolishness that's going on up there with our convention. Y'all right? Listen, I hope y'all right, because that's the direction I'm going. There's some things that they need to hear from their church people that are foolish. Listen, our fight ain't here. It's over yonder. Hey, let's keep the main thing the main thing. They're always coming up with these slogans for us to send money up there, to pay for all these billboards, and to keep all these folks in offices up there in our buildings that we got all over the country. Gloriana, someplace out in Texas. And we got two or three convention halls in the state of Georgia that are able to rent out. People make money. Listen, they make a pile of money up there. But I got news for you. Our money shouldn't go just to take care of those folks. Listen, send that money to missions. Try to win souls for Jesus, because that is the greatest thing that we'll ever do on this side. Listen, I get weary about it. Tonight I'm going to give a response to Mr. Greer. And only because we can do it online. And listen, will he hear it? Probably not. But I'll know I said it. Amen? Hey. You know what I'd hope? 48,000 Southern Baptist churches. 2 years ago, there was 51,000. You know what I'd hope? That about 30,000 of those preachers would have a backbone and say what they believe. Because I guarantee you, most of them are uneducated, just like I am. The vast majority of them are fellows that go to work every day and preach in a church on Sunday, and they hope to be okay with everybody in their association so they don't rock the boat. I got news for you. If all the Southern Baptist preachers were just like me, that worked every day, that went to work and done stuff, and they stood before their people and told this message, they wouldn't spew that foolishness at these conventions. It makes me weary. Genesis 1:28 commanded Adam and Eve. Said this, made this day. You don't have to turn. I'll read it to you. Genesis 1:28 said, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. That's what he said. I've heard that quoted forever. I wrote down several verses this week because I wanted to make sure. A lot of times it's verses that I've heard, and I look them up and I realize there's more in that verse than just that. You know what it also says? It says, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth and subdue it. You know what that means? Bring it under control. Govern it. Listen, I got news for you. Government in itself is a good thing. Hear me now, before you get all sideways and start throwing tomatoes, government in itself is a good thing. Listen, it'd be a dark day if everybody just had their piece of land and tried to do everything that just made them happy. It'd make a lot of folks that didn't have an opportunity sad. So government, in a way, is a good thing. And we got to be careful that we make sure we understand that we serve in a government that may not be perfect, and we have a government over in America. Listen, some folks need to vote differently. There's 75 counties in this country that's lost their minds. They don't agree with the rest of us. The rest of us are crazy. But you know what? That's their right. That's their right, man. They don't have to agree with us. That's the greatness of America. We don't all have to agree. You know what it ought to do? I think a lot of times, our last president went into office. I didn't agree with him. I prayed for him. Why? Because I'm an American. Listen, because I'm an American. I want America to make it. I want this to be a place where people can come from all over the world and hear about Jesus. I want this to be a place where we can send missionaries all over this world and take care of them when they're out there. I believe the Southern Baptists do that better than any group of people in the world. They send out more, take care of them, and that I enjoy. But this is something we ought to understand. Government's not specifically Christian. Government in and itself isn't a Christian thing, and that's a shame in some ways. But now, it's not specifically Christian, but I'm glad that we have government. Sometimes we get people in government that are completely, you know, they kneel down. I saw some of them kneel down in the rotundas out there. Several folks knelt down with the Kent cloth the other day, and they bowed down for 8 minutes and 46 seconds, or 49 seconds, however long it was that Mr. Floyd was killed up in Minneapolis. See, that was a crime against that man. Listen, and whoever did it ought to pay for it. There's no argument about that. So what are we fighting and arguing about? Why are we burning down our places? We agree about that. No. Other people's hijacked things are turning our America into something that we don't really want. We as Christians, listen, have to remember that the main thing is Jesus and Him crucified. And we have a responsibility to get this message out there. And we can do it. We can still do it. Most Americans, after seeing the mess on TV, I wrote some notes down, struggle to see authority as good. When you see all this, some people don't see authority as good. Authority can be good. People need to recognize that, even if you don't agree with it. I remember coaches throughout my lifetime playing ball. I didn't always agree with them. I didn't like Coach Rubin making me run so much. I said, Coach, I'm a big guy. You know, I probably ain't going to have to run far from here to there or here to there. If I have to go further than that, something went wrong. This play's busted. If I have to go further than there or further than there, we already got a problem. So it ain't my fault. You know, but he would want me to run. And then you play baseball. I don't know why they want you to run all the way around that outfield out there. All the way around the back. I've always hated running. Always hated running. I didn't agree with those coaches. You know what? But when it was all said and done, I was part of a team. I was part of a team. And to be part of that team, I need to do what the other team did, what the rest of the team did. We had to make sure that we did it in such a way that brought us all together. Listen, we're Americans. When I look around this country that God made, I believe God made it. Hey, I look around this country that some of the greatest things that man's ever done has come out of America. Some of the greatest people. Listen, Billy Graham has preached to millions all over the world. Old redneck from North Carolina. Listen, we look around this country and see all the greatness that it has become, and we've honored God. Our last president stood up and said, we're no longer a Christian nation. I don't know who he was talking to. And listen, I don't know who he was talking about. We're a nation of Christians. We're a nation of Muslims. We're a nation of Jehovah's Witnesses and Mormons. We're a nation of a whole bunch of people. But by and large, we're Christians. Listen, and as we as America, and listen, as we go out and we tell the story about Jesus, it changes people's lives. Christians ought to be good citizens. Secondly, praise the Lord, I'm on time. Secondly, no matter what government you assign yourself to, you ought to realize that government has some corruption in it. You look around this world, it doesn't matter what government you see or what government you're looking at, almost every single government that's in America today, Brother Chad, is corrupt in some kind of way. Listen, if I went up there to the State House up there, I could probably enjoy hanging out and eating with some of those fellas and going and hearing what they had to say, maybe going to church with them. The pastor from, I believe it's called Capitol Hill Baptist Church, four, five, maybe six blocks away from the White House, Pastor Mark Deaver made a statement the other day. He said, Christians are like cockroaches. I went, what do you mean by that? You know, the church full of senators, full of House of Representatives. He said, Christians are like cockroaches. He said, we can survive anything. Hey, I'm going to tell you something. There ain't one country on this earth that people say, well, that's a Christian country, except America. Well, look around. I mean, would you call Sweden a Christian nation? Would you call Mexico a Christian? No, whenever people talk about a Christian nation, they talk about America. Well, listen, that's why the folks over there in those sand huts over in the Middle East, you know why they want to kill us? Because they see us as the great Satan. We're the Jesus people. We're the folks that apprise Jesus. We're the folks that talk about Jesus. Listen, we as people got to understand that we need to sound the alarm regularly, who we are, whose we are, and who we follow. Listen, you don't have to agree with everybody. We don't have to be friendly and nice about when it comes to what we believe as Christians. We ought to stand on some things and say, listen, I get thinking about that because, you know, in Acts chapter 4, Peter and John were told by the government to stop preaching in the name of Jesus. The Sanhedrin, those folks. They was told not to do that anymore. What did Peter and John do? They just did it anyway. So the next day, chapter 5, you find them old boys in jail. You find them old boys locked up in jail. And the rulers come down and said, man, why'd you do that? He said, well, I tell you, it's better for us to obey God rather than you. So I'm going to tell you something. There is a place in Scripture where it gives us right for some civil disobedience. You all right? I ain't talking about burning down a Wendy's in Atlanta. I'm not talking about that. Hey, listen, I'm talking about Christians standing up and being who we say we are and sending our message to our leaders and our people that we're sick and tired of their foolishness because they respond to us. Nah, whether they do or don't, I don't know. You look around this world, and I get thinking about Christian nations. I can probably say this without worrying if you believe it or not, because I believe it. I feel closer in this world to Christians than even Americans. I mean, when I get to thinking about who I am as a child of the King, my relationship to my Christian brothers and sisters, I'm close to. It don't matter what country they're in. You okay? Listen, we go down to Mexico and do missions down there. There's some Mexican preachers down there that can't stand the way their government's run. We're the same. So all of us Christians, we have to live on this side. But while we're here, we have to be in governments. We have to be part of something. We have to be good citizens. Jesus even told, listen, if he told the Jewish people to render unto Caesar those things that render. If they could honor the Roman government in those days, we could honor ours. Y'all right? People, I tell everybody liking this. But we can honor our government. Listen, I love our government. I'm glad those folks said it like they did because we wouldn't be where we are today. But listen, across this world today, we see other Christians that have the same heart we do. And Christians kind of are like isolated folks, if you want to talk about it that way. I see Jesus when he shows up here on the scene with these guys. Here he is by himself, nobody to help him. Seems like he always has to give an account just for himself. We find Peter stepping up in front and cutting Malchus's ear off at the Garden of Gethsemane. But other than that, he has to stand on his own. Christians have to do that all the time. You know what we do when we go to other countries? Christians, they find them a church to go to. You know what the Muslims do in other worlds? Other countries, before they come to America, they go through classes that teaches them how to assimilate into our culture. They change what they believe outwardly so that we'll accept them for who they are. We as Christians don't do that. Listen, when we get, some of our boys get shipped to Japan in the army, what do they find them a church they go to, and they still believe the same things in Japan they believe in America. They still live their lives in Japan like they do in America. Some of them get sent off to Germany, serve their time, or some folks may move to South America. They may move over to India, but they still believe what they believe. You know why? Because at some point in our past, we accepted Christ Jesus into our hearts, and he saved us. Listen, and that made a difference. And now we take this book everywhere we go, and it changed us. See, this book dictates to us. And as we make our way through this world, we as Christians are pretty much the same worldwide. Listen, the Muslim faith tells them that they can lie to us. They can lie to us. You okay? They're about all right. You're looking up here kind of strange. But listen, they tell us they can lie to us as long as they can make it through, as long as they can get what they want and do what they want. They can lie to us. We can't lie to folks. Matter of fact, their nation, if you really want to go back to it, tells them that they need to be killing us. We always hear that slogan, but ours says to love them. What's different? Jesus. Hey, folks, we got the truth and everybody else don't. Listen, we have the truth here in God's Word, and we have to make sure that folks get it. I don't see how we can hardly do that, tearing up our community and burning it down. While we have some space for civil disputes, and we're able to go out there, I believe the Bible, I'm going to obey God before man. I won't ever do anything outside what God's Word dictates. You know, I look around and I see some of these things that are going on in this world, and I wonder how people can do those things in good faith and good conscience. Listen, they're going to answer to God one day. All these abortion clinics get set up around America, they're going to answer to God one day. Listen, I'm afraid that we as Christians are going to answer to God too. That we hadn't stacked it four people deep all over America every day. We got enough Americans, we got enough Christian Americans sitting home Monday through Friday that could go out to an abortion clinic and just hold a sign, Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you. Civil disobedience. We don't agree with it. The government says it's okay, I don't. Government says it's okay for them to do it Roe versus Wade, I don't. You know, up in New York, they just took away some restrictions saying it's okay. It's okay for them to abort non-viable babies right up to the age of birth and even right after when they can't. They want to deliver the child and then have a look at it and then decide whether or not it lives or dies. Folks, there's a problem in America. There's a problem in America. Lastly, Christians, we are fully accountable to God. Listen, when it's all said and done, nobody's going to write on my tombstone, I'll guarantee you, that, boy, his president, Donald Trump, loved him. Nobody will say that about old Brother Ray. Donald Trump ain't got a clue who I am. Nobody will ever say that Ronald Reagan loved Brother Ray. I don't know who the next president's coming up, who are. You know, I got my own druthers about who they ought to be, but, you know, I'll keep them to myself until the Lord makes them happen, amen. But nobody will ever say how our country, you know, loved Brother Ray. That's probably not going to happen. But I'm going to tell you, what I can tell you is that my Savior loves Brother Ray. Hey, listen, what I can tell you today, standing up here of a truth, is that my Savior died on a cross for my sins 2,000 years ago. Give me right to stand up here and talk about him. And he told me to make sure I go out and tell everybody and baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. I've been given an edict to go out and do those things. That's what we're doing. That's what we do as Christians. Jesus told the Pharisees and the Herodians to render to Caesar those things that are Caesar's. Not so many remember that Jesus ended his teachings by saying we render to God the things that are God's. While Jesus commanded obedience to the state, he undermined its final authority with this phrase. Authority may be good, but it can be abused. You believe that? Well, I look around here today and I see authority and how it can be taken advantage of, and people vote themselves into office just long enough to get maybe their pet project done. Listen, I don't think anybody that runs for office, people that run for office ought to be there for other people. Y'all all right? Some of y'all got some folks in politics, y'all ain't liking this very much. I believe if you run for office, you ought to be there for other folks. Because those folks are the ones that's paying your salary. Those folks are taking care of it. I believe we as people ought to do it that way. Authority can be good, but it can be abused. Consider the Sanhedrin, as they told James, Peter. They told Peter and John to keep their mouths closed. See, the government will do that. But I tell you what, the government has also will also try to do in the future. The Bible says in the book of Revelations, chapter 13, that there's going to come a time when the government, a rebel government, will want to put a mark on its people. That's what government will do for you. Folks, you better be careful. Hey, we better be careful as a nation. And listen, and that's why I've been stewed over for a couple of weeks. And listen, I wasn't very proud of when our SBC president waded into that water. That wasn't none of his business. Ain't none of his business. His business is what we tell him his business is. Y'all okay? And listen, when he waited in that business, he's going to draw our ire. Sadly, I think he expects it. Sadly, I think he expects it. But Revelation calls Christians to obey government. If we Christians are ever tempted, listen to me, if we as Christians are ever tempted to invest all our hopes and dreams in government, a lot of people do that. A lot of people say that government is the end-all and do-all of all things. Government is that crowd, folks, that has told people that you're suspect if you spank your child. How about that? Listen, growing up, my mom used to spank me to stay in shape. And I think about all the whippings we got, and I got a little brother who's about 38 or 9. Mama may get him for the weeks out. He's building his house, trying to move into it. He's been ugly to her this past week because he's kind of short-tempered. Listen, Mama may get him for the weeks out. Amen. I want to be there to see it, so I'm hanging around all I can. Listen, but what's happening with the government right now? Hey, listen, they look at us as Christians, and when we spank our children and try to make them do right, and according to God's word, you spare the rod, you spoil the child. Listen, we take care of that business the way God's word says. Government looks at us strange when we do that. They don't look at these folks when they abort these children strange. On one hand, they say we shouldn't spank our kids, but they can kill other babies. Hey, can I tell you, in a three-year period in New York, they had more abortions in that three-year period than they had babies born alive. Folks, we got a problem. That problem can only be fixed by Jesus. Though Jesus sowed the seeds of demise for Israel's nationalization and Roman paganism, he focused his efforts on a much more important revolution. Jesus focused all his attention on a revolution that was a lot bigger than just trying to upset Israel. You see what he did? When he came to Israel, he said, listen, guys, I got some news for you. It's going to kind of upset you. That's why the Pharisees didn't like him. So they hated him because he came in and said, you know, that whole thing about just you guys going, it's a problem. Here's what we're going to do. I'm going to die so that everybody can go to heaven. Well, that's awesome, isn't it? That made it good for us. Whosoever will, let him come. Amen. You see, he died so that everybody... Well, that messed up the people, the Hebrew, the Israel. They looked at it and said, well, wait a minute. This is ours. God said, no, it's everybody's. So Jesus sowed those seeds. And then he sowed the seeds against the Roman government when he told them that there's only one God. See, they served many gods. So he goes, Jesus, Jesus was the original protester. And he come into Galilee, come into Nazareth, man, rocking the boat, went down to Jerusalem, listen, turned over the money changers' tables, rose people from the dead, grew arms back, went to a cemetery, brought Lazarus out. Listen, this man rocked the boat everywhere he went. That's our leader. He's the one that came here and told us what we ought to do and what we ought to follow. And sometimes we stand back like sheep and do nothing. It's sad we as Americans have the greatest country, I believe, that God ever gave to mankind. And we stand back and allow foolish, ungodly leaders to do what they do. If we as Christians voted, we'd change all this. Listen, I get to thinking about why Jesus came. You know, we sometimes say that the coins ought to go back to Caesar and we pay our dues. Listen, Jesus came too to collect something as well, but he came to collect those of us that were his. He came to collect his elect. Now, I believe we ought to give God what is God's. So let me give you a couple of verses as we get ready to go. I believe you ought to pay your taxes. Y'all right? Everybody still paying their taxes? Listen, if you're going to stay on your place, you better pay your taxes. Amen. I also believe we ought to choose a candidate. I believe we ought to go out there and vote for somebody. Listen, I ain't Democrat or Republican. I'm Christian. Listen, as we get up every day, we ought to pray for our leadership. But listen, if that leadership don't honor God, we ought to be praying that God does some things to change and put godly people in those places so that we can be in a nation where we don't have some of the things that we're having. I like this, what it says here in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6. We as citizens... Listen, we as citizens of America, but as Christians, are looking for a better country. Now, I'm not talking about one on this side. Look what Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6 says. But now they desire, listen to this, but now they desire, that's us, that's y'all. That's the blood-washed, born-again children of the King. But they desire a better country that is heavenly. Wherefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he hath prepared for them a city. But I can't wait. I can't wait to get to heaven. You ever wonder what it's going to be like when you take your first moments, your first stroll into heaven? You ever wonder what it's going to be like inside those walls? So it's going to have walls. You know, I see some of these castles on TV, and I see some of these things. I read books about old boroughs that these people built to keep other folks from invading them. They all had walls. And I get thinking what it's going to be like when we go through those pearly gates. And we walk down those streets of gold. And our first few moments that we're in glory. And we see all the things that God had intended for us. And then we realize how much more we could have and should have done. Listen, folks, I got news for you. The most important thing ain't these 60 or 70 years that we're going to live here. Or 80 or 90 or how many God gives you. That's not the most important thing that we have. Just one question during that time is the greatest is, what you going to do about Jesus? Because listen, our eternity, our future lies somewhere else on another shore. Our eternity, our desire lays somewhere else way over yonder. And that's what I look for. I don't want to bog myself down here. I don't want to get so caught up in this foolishness that takes the main emphasis away from the main thing, which is Jesus. We look around here and we see our government, we see our spiritual leaders, we see all these folks getting right on this bandwagon and following the devil. I said that, following the devil right around. That's what happens. But just stand up and preach the word. Just stand up and shout about how good Jesus is. If that ain't good enough for your church, just let them vote you out. But listen, just follow the word, get in that book. And listen, the governments are always going to be corrupt. They're always going to be evil. They always have been. But we as people, we as Christians have to live here. Hey, and I got news for you. The King is coming. I like that song. You hear that song? Oh, the King is coming. The King is coming. I just heard the trumpet sounding, and now his face I see. Oh, the King is coming. The King is coming. Praise God, he's coming for me. Boy, I get thinking all the time about Jesus coming back. And I see all this foolishness on TV. And I don't even want to pay it any mind. You know why? Because I say, come on, Lord. I can understand why the writer in the Bible says, even so, Lord, come quickly. So come on, come get us all. See all this craziness here on earth. In closing, our elected officials are worthy of honor, but not hope. I say that to you again. Our elected officials are worthy of honor, but not hope. Hey, my hope of redemption doesn't lie in anything they're doing up there on Pennsylvania Avenue. My hope and security has nothing to do with anything that's happened here at Charlton County, the way they're doing taxes, or in Brantley County, or where it has nothing to do with any of those folks. My hope and security lies in a home that is so far away we can't even see it from here, but we gaze that direction every day. Hey, listen, my desire lies somewhere else, a shore I hadn't even seen yet. They talk about crystal rivers and beautiful. I can't hardly wait to see it. I can't wait to walk into that city first day and look down the alleys and see that. I can't wait. But I get to thinking about how good it's going to be first day. What's the first thing we're going to smell when you get to heaven? What do they say? Amen. Cinnamon rolls. Amen. So on my part, oh Lord, put me in the bakery district. You know, well, what I'm so excited about, we ain't got to have cars. You got all day. Amen. And it don't never get dark, so it's just one day. It's forever. And time don't matter anymore. Am we good? And listen, we can shout and tell Brother Roger. I know he's listening. We can shout and tell Brother Roger. Brother Roger, ain't going to be no sickness over there, brother. They're going to have to go to the hospital for no more chemotherapy either. We got folks that we know and love that's sick and going through tough days. I got news for you. There's going to come a time. There won't be no more tough days. Amen. Listen, I can't wait to get together singing that choir. Woo-hoo, I like a choir. We need to get us a choir going. Amen. I seen Brother Benji go, oh. Listen, I like a choir. I like folks getting together and all the voices raised together, singing, letting our Savior know whose we are. Man, I'm looking forward to heaven. We got to live here, though. We got to live here. And while we're here, Let's let them know we roosters and not hens. Y'all okay with that? Well, I said that, y'all right? Listen, let them know that we as blood-washed, born-again, children of the King, believe that our leaders ought to live like the leaders that founded this country. That's what I believe. Will it always be like that? Probably not. I'll die saying the same thing. And when I get ushered through the gates, I'm going to say, I told you. We have a job to do here as Americans. But we have a bigger job to do here as Christians. We're children of the King. We ought to act like it. Children of the King. A folks set apart, set aside, and set ready to go to a homeland that's so far away. Are you ready to go? Hey, what if Jesus come back today? Where would that leave you? What if Christ stepped out from the upper atmosphere today? The horn sounded, doo-doo, and you heard it. What would you do if at this very moment people started disappearing out of the pews, out of these seats, these chairs? What would you do if my Bible and these garments and this watch all spooked and I was gone? I wonder what's going to be like when the rapture of the church takes place. I believe that the rapture of the church is going to take place during my lifetime. And I want to preach like every single message is my very last one. It's the last time. This is it. This is the last time I got to preach. If it is, what will we do? What will it be like when we go that way? I had a man say one time, he said, well, I'm just going to be standing by you. That way, whenever the rapture church takes place, I'll just grab a hold of you and I'll go with you. I said, I'll tell you how you can practice. He said, how's that? I said, get you a 30-06 rifle and hold the barrel, put the butt on the ground, hook your toe on the trigger, and with your free hand, try to catch the bullet. He said, ugh. I said, that's what God feels about sin. He ain't going to let it in. Listen, you know how you're going to get there? It's because you gave your life to Jesus. Listen, we might give our money, our government. You know what we do? We give our hearts to Jesus, and He has us. That's why I'm close to people in Mexico, and I got a Christian brother now because of this, the internet. I got a Christian brother down in Zimbabwe, I think, South Africa. Well, boy's building a mission down there for kids, orphans. Well, he's building down there. I'm keeping up. Anybody else watching that? Anybody see him? Pull him up. Look, he's building brick walls. All his pictures of him, he's wore out building brick walls for kids. Listen, I'm friends with that guy. Never met him. Just talked to him online. I got more in common with him than a lot of those folks living in California. Because we're children of the King. And can I tell you something? That's the title that matters the most. Are you a child of the King? If Christ came today, would you go to heaven? Hey, that's the most important question you'll ever answer. I did a funeral this past week for a man who was 93 years old. 93 years old. I visited him 6 months ago in the hospital. He was there. And several years ago, I did his grandson's funeral. Got killed into my drive at my house. Him and another one of my youth. I'd led that little boy to the Lord about 3 months earlier. Him and another little girl got killed at the end of our drive. I talked to this old man, and I went in there. I said, how you doing, Mr. Junior? He said, I'm good. We laughed and cut up a little bit. I said, you remember that time old Brian come driving up in your yard, that old truck, backwards, in reverse? He said, yeah, he just laughed. Brian got out of the truck. I said, man, tell him what you can do forward. He said, it won't go forward. He's about 9. He drove around backwards everywhere. Mr. Junior laughed. I said, Mr. Junior, old Brian's in heaven. I laid him to Jesus before he died. I said, Mr. Junior, are you saved? Would you go to heaven when you die? Big long come out of him. He said, when I was young, I got saved. When I was young, I got saved. Listen, I'll tell you something. You need to be able, when somebody asks you, when you got saved, or are you saved, that you gave your heart to Jesus when you was young, or when you was middle-aged, or when you was an adult. We baptize folks in their 80s. Listen, there ain't a time limit or a time zone. If you don't know Jesus, now is the time. Amen. So if you're here today without Jesus, it's your time. right where you are. I'm gonna pray for you. Just keep your seat. I'm gonna pray for you. Lord, we love you and we thank you, God, that you love us. God, as we come to this time in our service, there may be people in our midst never been saved. We recognize, God, that your coming might not be very far off. All this foolishness going on in this world, Lord, they're rioting everywhere. And Lord, we look around and we just wonder, Lord, how long are you going to allow this to go on before you say, that's it, and you come for us? Help us, Lord. Help us to honor you with our lives. Help us to honor our country and be obedient to our government up to a point. Help us, God, to be citizens that other people look at that aren't Christian, but when they see us doing the right thing, Lord, that it, according to Romans, shuts their mouths because they see us doing it the right way. Help us, God, be good citizens. But Father, living here on this earth, the only thing, the best thing we'll ever do is come to know you as our Savior. I pray for that person right now who's never been saved. That they'll have the strength to step out of their pew and come down here and let me know, Brother Ray, I've never been saved. And Lord, I'll help them from there. I pray, God, for our country. And Lord, I pray that today folks will come and kneel down and pray for their country today. That they'll pray for their president. That they'll pray for their city, Atlanta, today, and all the things that are going on there in that. Lord, we love you and we thank you for Jesus and his rebelliousness a long time ago. It's in his name that we pray. Amen. If you would, please stand. If you'd like to pray today, please come. I guarantee you, somebody needs prayer. I guarantee you, there's somebody on your prayer list that you've been thinking about that you ought to be praying for. Come bring them to the altar. The altar is mentioned 433 times in this King James Version of the Bible. It's important. So there's folks that need prayer. Our country needs prayer. If you're here today and you're not saved, it'd be my prayer that you come to know Jesus before you leave. Before you leave this place, it'd be my prayer that you come to know Jesus. Are you saved? If you're not, come right down here and say, Brother Ray, I need to be saved. Listen, you're not guaranteed tomorrow or next week or next month. You're not guaranteed late this evening. And if God is pressing on your heart this morning to be saved, now is your time. Now's your time. Don't wait. Don't waste this opportunity. Have time to come if you'd like to. You say, Brother, I've been saved for years. Is your joy still good? A lot of times Christians live their whole adult lives. They got saved when they were young people. And they spend their whole adult lives trying to recapture the joys they had at summer camp when they was a kid. You can. You can. It's work. See, God expects things out of us. God expects us to work for the kingdom. We're part of that group of people now that goes and wins souls. We're part of that group of people that keeps a church going, that cuts its grass, that, you know, fixes its roof, that keeps its air conditioners, that keeps the carpet. It's work. But when you do it, isn't it joyful? Well, we got people around. I talk about Brother Larry. I've known Brother Larry for Larry Carter for a long, long time. I ain't never seen so much joy in his face as I've seen the past couple of months. You know what he's doing? Serving. Oh boy, done found his spot. Hey, I'd beg you to find your spot. Find your place where God wants to use you. And there you're going to find some joy. You're going to find yourself some joy putting your hand to the plow of the work that God gave you to do. There's a lot of joy in that. Amen? Amen. Thank you, sis. God's good to us. Does anybody have anything to say before we dismiss? Woo-hoo. Y'all all right? Are y'all all right? I know some of y'all used to sitting home eating popcorn and watching this thing on TV. But y'all got to get dressed and shave and put on deodorant. Amen. Come on down here and be with us. It was so good to see a crowd of people coming. For our visitors that came to be with our families, what an awesome thing. Y'all are much loved. It's easy to see. And we want to tell y'all's families that we're going to love on them too. As long as they're here, we're going to do our best to take care of their needs and make sure they're hearing what God's Word has to say. It's very important. And for those little fellows to be running around here tearing up the walls. You know, the Bible says, you know, I can't remember exactly how it said, word for word, but it says, where there's no oxen, the stalls are clean. But with an oxen, there's a lot of produce, a lot of good things happen. So when young people are here, you know what they're going to tear up stuff. They're going to write on the walls about this high down. We ought to put saran wrap from this high down. But listen, every little mark and every little spilled something that you see and every little nick and crayon mark, hey, a little fella come to God's house. Come to God's house and he heard the word that day. So, man, listen, just bring them. Just bring them. They don't bother me in church. They cry all they want to. We'll set them all down here. We'll preach to them. Amen? That's where church ought to be. Where church ought to be. God bless you. I pray you have a good day today. Church tonight, 6 o'clock. Amen. We're going to have a short meeting today with the youth leaders. Anybody have anything to say before we dismiss? Amen. Brother Chad, you dismiss us.